In a 6-3 vote, the conservative majority of the US Supreme Court ruled that a high school football coach had a constitutional right to pray at the 50-yard line after his team's games. Now, this may not sound like anything necessarily significant, but let me assure you, it definitely is, and you should be very concerned for the reasons that I'll explain. But let's go ahead and look at this decision first. So this per the New York Times, Justice Neil M. Gorsuch, writing for the majority, said the prayers of the coach, Joseph Kennedy, were protected by the First Amendment. Mr. Kennedy had served as an assistant coach at a public high school in Bremerton, Washington, near Seattle. For 8 years, he routinely offered prayers after games, with students often joining him. He also led and participated in prayers in the locker room. The school board instructed Mr. Kennedy not to pray if it interfered with his duties or involved students. And ultimately, the school did not want students to feel that they were being forced to pray to play, which I'm sure you can probably guess may be a feeling, especially when you have an individual who's in a position of power being the assistant coach there. And they also didn't want anyone to think that the public school was leading in this prayer, as it would violate that separation of church and state. But when Coach Kennedy continued to pray, and of course he'd do it on the 50-yard line after games before everyone, well, his contract wasn't renewed. So after reviewing the case, Justice Gorsuch and his conservative majority, they went ahead and concluded this. Respect for religious expressions is indispensable to life in a free and diverse republic. Whether those expressions take place in a sanctuary or on a field, and whether they manifest through the spoken word or a bowed head, he wrote. Here, a government entity sought to punish an individual for engaging in a brief, quiet, personal religious observance. That's really interesting the way that it was framed, because it definitely seemed to be maybe misconstruing some facts. And that was an observation that was also noted in the dissent, which was written by Justice Sonia Sotomayor. So she and the other two liberal justices of the court, well, they explained why the ruling itself was so problematic, as they did call out the misrepresentations that the majority essentially was using to support its opinion. And this is what Justice Sotomayor wrote. Today's decision is particularly misguided because it elevates the religious rights of a school official who voluntarily accepted public employment and the limits that public employment entails over those of his students who are required to attend school and who this court has long recognized are particularly vulnerable and deserving of protection. Now, this ruling, it does come just days after the Supreme Court ruled that essentially, school districts can be forced to pay tuition at religious schools as well as public schools. So that's basically saying we can go ahead and use your taxpayer money to fund religion. And that definitely seems to be a breach of this whole church and state situation, which is one of the founding elements of our nation. Well, you again may not fully appreciate the significance of this, but let me go ahead and show you why this is of grave importance when it comes to really reinforcing this Christian ideology in our system. Watch this.
We need to start to roll things back in order to begin to restore order. And yes, that might look like rolling back the rights of women over the past 100 years. That's probably going to look exactly like that to most people, especially liberals. But that is what is needed to be done. There's something next on the horizon, because gay marriage is going to be going away. Contraceptives are going to be going away. Anal sex, you know the anal sex that you like to have, that's going to be going away as well. And many other things are going to be going away, because there is a true rise of Christian nationalism in this country.
Indeed, there is a rise in Christian nationalism, and that is a problem. That man that you heard speaking is a white nationalist named Vincent James, and he sees it and fully appreciates it and glorifies it, this rise in this Christian white nationalist front. Again, our nation was purportedly founded on this separation of church and state, such that we wouldn't have kind of this theocracy in place where you had leaders using any kind of religious body or religious ideology to dictate what we choose to do, and such that we will not be oppressed for it. And as hypocritical as our founding fathers were, we can definitely agree that that was supposed to be at least the agreement from the jump. But it seems that the US Supreme Court is not really here for following precedent or even abiding by what we do know the law to be and the actual US Constitution to say. But that's just my read of things, Ben.
Yeah, I mean, there's so much to this. Like, first and foremost, what the Supreme Court is doing is very obviously, in their view, the words on the page and their decisions are just a means to an end. They already know the conclusions they want to make. They want to make the conclusions that allow them to turn the right to practice your own religion into a right to oppress people. Because, and this is one thing that a lot of people forget, the United States wasn't predominantly Christian for a pretty long time, actually. If you look even just 100 years ago in the 19 teens, you'll see the average church membership is something around 15 to 20% of the American population. It only got really big and really popular during the Eisenhower administration, and the reason for that was basically twofold. People viewed the right to practice your religion as an open door to challenge laws against segregation and as an open door to push an extreme, violent, anti-communist and anti-black message across the country. Quite literally, they viewed religious rights as an opportunity to justify oppression, as an opportunity to have elected officials, to have government officials going out of their way to maintain segregation and to maintain their reactionary beliefs to resist any type of forward societal progress, which is why Christianity in America, you can actually see this especially with Catholics, are very, very different from Catholics in other parts of the world. You actually notice a lot of Catholics in the United States are very angry with the Pope, that the Pope dares to suggest we do things like help poor people and, you know, not let school shooters get access to guns to shoot up schools and things like that. There's a lot of American Catholics that are very, very angry about that. And the reason is because Christianity in the United States was really invented out of whole cloth by right-wing PR departments and marketing advertising agencies in order to sell this ridiculous over-the-top brand of racist capitalism. And that really has been like the defining force for the political right. And today it's coming to this pivotal moment where they're revealing themselves to have no concern or care for any institutions, for any other people other than predominantly white evangelicals in the United States.
Oh, without a doubt. It's always interesting how so many things are rooted in racism and trying to create this divide based on people's appearances and their race. And the thing is, we've seen Christianity take that exact same path, as well as the Constitution. And when it comes to the law and the application, and we're seeing it being driven home even harder now, where we have these US Supreme Court justices who are completely and totally comfortable with just trimming a little fat off the Constitution in order to serve their end goal, which is this white Christian nationalist ideology that they want to implement, and even if it means to the destruction of our nation and to the destruction of individuals.